वैद्य ऑल्सो अटैच विद द जुपिटर हॉस्पिटल थाने एंड फोर्टिस हॉस्पिटल मुलुंड मुंबई. टुडे डॉक्टर वैद्य विल टॉक ऑन द बीटा ब्लॉकर्स इन हार्ट फेलियर एंड आई एम हैंड ओवरिंग द सेशन टू डॉक्टर वैद्य. एंड एट द एंड ऑफ रिस्पेक्टेड ऑडियंस यू कैन आस्क क्वेश्चंस इन वन टू वन विद द डॉक्टर, इंटरेक्ट विद द डॉक्टर एंड इन द क्वेश्चन इन क्वेश्चन आंसर बॉक्स यू कैन चैट बॉक्स यू कैन ड्रॉप योर क्वेश्चंस विद डॉक्टर सतीश वैद्य. सो डॉक्टर आई एम हैंड ओवरिंग द सेशन टू यू. थैंक यू.
Yeah, thank you very much and welcome all the faculty in the audience. Now today's topic is very interesting. See, discovery was of beta blockers has revolutionized the treatment of cardiovascular diseases, but unfortunately in between beta blockers suffered lot of controversy and they were even blacklisted by the top associations all over the world, like JNC, then British Hypertension Society and European Hypertension Society, as far as treatment of hypertension was concerned. But not to forget that all beta blockers are not the same. That's why unnecessarily everything is considered as side effects of beta blockers. And with the discovery of newer beta blockers, we have very good drugs in the treatment of both coronary artery disease, hypertension, and cardiac failure. Now, concept of autonomic nervous system, as in this slide is seen, was generated in 1948 with catecholamines having alpha and beta blockers. So Black won the Nobel Prize for discovering the first beta blocker in the 60s, that was propranolol. And the propranolol was the non-selective beta blockers, hydrophilic beta blockers, but very, very useful in those days. Further came to know about the beta 1 and beta 2 receptors. So this is again history of discovery of beta blockers. And this particular slide showed the journey of newer beta blockers right from the 60s. Propranolol was used in and out for treatment of hypertension and related conditions. But subsequently, we came to know the side effects like disturbance in the glucose metabolism, peripheral vascular disease. Most important was the bronchospasm, and then of course, nightmares and so on and so forth. But beta blocker like propranolol is popular in the treatment of non-cardiac conditions like headache, essential tremors, anxiety, tachycardia, and portal hypertension. Propranolol, in those days, beta blockers were considered as having negative inotropic effect. So even conditions like mitral stenosis, we used to be scared to give beta blockers like propranolol, which is now important molecules. Beta blockers play a very important role in mitral stenosis, where especially patient develops ventral atrial fibrillation fast ventricular rate, because already a stenomitral valve, tachycardia compromises the cardiac output, and therefore whether it is sinus or AF, to reduce the heart rate is very important. So propranolol was used those days, but with a fear that it may precipitate cardiac failure. Then we realized that mitral stenosis, there would be a left ventricular failure, but there is left atrial failure. Now, subsequently, in the 80s, we got metoprolol. Metoprolol was there earlier. A couple of trials were there, but again took a backseat. And atenolol became very popular. And the molecule was actually introduced by Copran, you will all remember. But it was sold to Cadila, I suppose, and then they continued. Atenolol became very friendly with other antihypertensive agents for the treatment, like amlodipine as the ACEs and ARBs were available. But most important landmark after 1990 was bisoprolol, which is a very important molecule. Labetalol has been there in and out, very rarely used days except for emergency-induced hypertension, and now it has emerged out for treatment of hypertension emergencies because this is the only molecule which is available for intravenous use. Ismolol was also there for very ultra-short-acting drug, but again did not survive. Now with the availability, sotalol also is very good molecule, especially useful for hypertension and cardiac arrhythmias because its anti-arrhythmic property, selectively used for this particular indication. And now we have in 2000 onwards the three most important beta blockers that are bisoprolol, metoprolol, carvedilol, which are approved for treatment of cardiac failure. The concept of downregulation of beta receptors and control the heart rate as well as decreased oxygen consumption plays an important role. Even today, after the introduction of the ARNI, beta blockers still remain the main drug of choice in combination with ARNI. Earlier, we used to give patients with A for cardiac failure. So, beta blockers like carvedilol, like metoprolol, and bisoprolol have been approved for treatment of cardiac failure. So that is the story. Now in 75, this is the first report where beta blockers used for treatment of cardiac failure. The conventional as seen is like and the groups received and a significant reduction increase in the survival. You can see the yellow line is the line of survival, whereas the conventional digitized diuretics is the other line. Significant increase in the survival with addition of beta blockers to the conventional therapy. This was right going on right from 75. So therefore, so as I said earlier, the beta blockers, all beta blockers cannot be included in the same group. Every beta blocker has an identity and different mode of action, different side effect profile, and therefore we have to study them individually. And therefore it depends upon the potency and duration of action, the cardioselectivity as we discussed about beta 1 and beta 2 selectivity, unopposed action, the intrinsic sympathomimetic activity, and lipid solubility as we discuss about propranolol, where it was having brain side effects. This is what in short we have beta 1, beta 2, alpha and beta. Of course, beta blockers don't act on alpha. Alpha blockers are useful for treatment of hypertension, whether you give in combination or otherwise. Now till say 2017, majority of associations were not recommending beta blockers as the drugs of choice for treatment of hypertension. But Indian Hypertension Society was the first one to suggest that beta blockers should be given in addition to regular combination that has been recommended, like ACE inhibitors or ARBs, diuretic, calcium channel blocker, and beta blockers in those patients who are young, those patients who have tachycardia, anxiety, and of course, what we call compelling indications like ischemic heart disease and cardiac failure and cardiac arrhythmias, where beta blockers is a must. So that, and subsequently it was followed that the ACCHA came out with the suggestion that there's nothing like start with AC, add a diuretic, add a calcium channel blockers. You can choose any drug from any group out of these as the first line and go on adding depending upon the patient's response. So all drugs are equated, and the consulting physician or the consulting cardiologist or the treating doctor has a liberty to start the treatment of antihypertension from the any groups depending upon the patient profile. So again, main factors which contribute to effect: beta 1 selectivity, beta 2 selectivity, vasodilatation, like intrinsic myometic activities, and the beta blockers like nebivolol has a vasodilatory effect, and it is safe in patients with COPD and bronchial asthma because it has got a property of liberating nitrous oxide, has a vasodilatory effect, and therefore this is exclusively can be used in patients with COPD and bronchial asthma. Beta 1 selectivity is highest for bisoprolol, as you see in this. On the contrary, negative beta 1 selectivity is for propranolol. Then comes metoprolol, atenolol, and highest is bisoprolol. And therefore, it has got least side effects, and that makes metoprolol the safe drugs for patients with even with erectile dysfunction, and even patients who can be given bisoprolol during surgery also. It has got a more than 3 times cardioselectivity. This is a comparison between carvedilol, metoprolol, and bisoprolol. So it has got 3.4 times cardioselectivity than atenolol and 3.3 from metoprolol. And as seen in this, carvedilol has to be given twice a day, metoprolol either once or twice, but bisoprolol is because of long action, we'll come to that, can be given only once a day. It's a truly once a day molecule. Now this is the pharmacokinetics, the elimination is 12 to 12 hours, atenolol and metoprolol is less, therefore they need to be given twice a day. Then absorption doesn't, bioavailability is 88%, protein bound is 30%, so that there is a prolonged action of this molecule and proves superior to other beta blockers. Now here again the same thing, absorption more than 90%, and the clearance is as compared to metoprolol and carvedilol, first pass effect. Most important thing which is seen in his slide is protein binding, elimination half-life, bioavailability is the highest, absorption is good, and metabolism 50% inactive. Otherwise, it is cleared by the kidneys and the liver. Therefore, it doesn't interfere with any other molecule as seen by the degradation enzymes. And then 50% is renal elimination and 50% is hepatic. And therefore, in mild to moderate liver and kidney disease, the dose need not be adjusted. Only precaution is that it should not exceed 10 milligrams. In severe liver and kidney impairment, actually speaking, we hardly give 10 milligrams because most of the patients develop a lot of bradycardia with even 5 milligrams. So therefore, we can go up to 10 milligrams if it needs to be to have. As I mentioned earlier, it has got a least effect on erectile dysfunction as compared to placebo, enalapril and amlodipine. So quite safe in patients with productive life. Route of elimination, as I mentioned earlier, it is 50% by liver, 50% by kidney as compared to other molecules. Therefore, the drug is available for action in these conditions. Then it can be used in dialyzed patients also. There's hardly any effect on the kidney. So the atenolol, metoprolol, and bisoprolol are extensively cleared by hemodialysis as compared to the nucleobed. So they don't accumulate. The main conclusion is that they don't accumulate and therefore don't have long-term cumulative effect like it happens with digitalis. As in a patient with kidney failure, usually we reduce the dose of digitalis. So here it is not required unless patient is on high-grade renal failure and it affects the heart rate. Then this is what is shown, mild to moderate. We don't have to bother about the reduction heart rate. Hepatic also the same thing. And therefore, its safety is proved in hepatic and renal impairments unless patient got advanced renal failure. So the properties are, it's a beta 1 selective beta blocker. No adverse effect on lipid metabolism. No adverse effect on glucose metabolism. as it used to happen with propranolol is better than atenolol. Atenolol has got peripheral side effect like peripheral vascular disease. Therefore, it is taking a back seat. Better 24 hours coverage because long plasma half-life and protein binding. And therefore, obviously, sustained BP control, no BP variability, which is deleterious to the brain and the heart. And it does not suddenly produce tachycardia or bradycardia during exercise, which becomes a totally a physiological action. So preferred beta blockers for treatment of heart failure, angina, and hypertension without complications. So this is has been recommended for isoprolol. This is a very common situation that a patient with hypertension with or without diabetes or smoking develops atherosclerosis, left ventricular hypertrophy, followed by coronary artery disease. Then they develop either cardiac arrhythmias and sudden death. They may develop strokes. And ultimately, they develop myocardial infarction because of coronary artery disease or cardiac failure because of either left ventricular hypertrophy leading in diastolic heart failure and reduction in systolic function leading to congestive heart failure, which is the common scenario. And therefore, cardioprotection with beta blockers is achieved by inhibition of the activity of the sympathetic nervous system, leading to both reduction in blood pressure, heart rate, and improving the status of the patients from cardiac failure. So again, to repeat, the indication for bisoprolol has widened. Apart from hypertension, you can give it post-MI, you can give it hypertension with coronary artery disease, hypertension with tachycardia, of course, heart failure. Similar to carvedilol, bisoprolol, mesoprolol, bisoprolol is nowadays available even up to the strength of 1.25, 2.55 and 10. And you have a multiple choice depending upon the patient's profile. And this is what happens. The judicious use of beta blockers, you can use it LV dysfunction, systolic dysfunction, and you can use it with diastolic dysfunction also. And these are the three main beta blockers approved by European Heart Association and even ACC/AHA. That ...1.25 and you can go up to 10 milligrams. Double the dose every 2 weeks. Prolol 3.125, you can go up to 25 milligrams. Bitoprolol, you can start with 12.5 and go up to 200 milligrams depending upon the patient's tolerance. And nebivolol, again 1.25 to 10 milligrams, right up to 12 weeks. This is what is recommended. The same sympathetic nervous system blockade, again start with 1.25 and go up to, prefer bitoprolol because it's more beta selective. Stagger timing with ACE inhibitors or ARBs, which are a common combination for patients with congestive heart failure. If you have patients with low cardiac output states, then this is what has to be followed. Those patients who develop low BP while on bisoprolol, then you have to follow the following instructions. The stagger means you can reduce the dose of ACE inhibitors or introduction of ACE to the beta blockers may be deferred. Then defer the timings of the molecule. As you said, take with meals and without for slow absorption. Then take in the evening rather than the morning and reduce the dose of diuretics. And I would like to add one more thing, that reduce the dose of even the nitrates which the patient may be taking in order to have the low output states as seen in this particular slide. And therefore, these doses can be adjusted depending upon the pressure and the heart rate. So this is one of the same thing which we discussed just now. To summarize, the timing of the dosage, the timing of ACE inhibitors and beta blocker combination, decreasing diuretics and nitroglycerin or nitrates. So these are the effects of the three main beta blockers which are approved. The annual mortality is significantly reduced, and the main trial undergone using beta blocker are CBIS-2, CBIS-3, which we'll discuss right now. So here also, as compared to placebo, there was a significant reduction in the annual mortality. As compared to placebo, MERIT-HF, the popular trial, metoprolol, and the Copernicus for carvedilol, which of course showed the highest reduction in mortality. And this particular trial plus the the US carvedilol program and the Copernicus trial using carvedilol was terminated prematurely because significant reduction, look at this, significant reduction, risk reduction of 65, it was 35. And CBIS-2 and MERIT-HF have a reduction of 34%. So these four, this is a profile of the meds that are approved for congestive heart failure. Again, same thing, selected trials, US carvedilol, Copernicus, MERIT-HF, and CBIS. CBIS is related to bisoprolol. One of the same thing in the tabulated form, that was in the graphical form. So, to analyze the CBIS trial, cardiac insufficiency bisoprolol studies, there are 1, 2, and 3. 1994, they studied bisoprolol against placebo, a very small number of patients, followed up for 23 months, and the primary endpoint was death, which are significantly reduced. But bisoprolol versus placebo repeated on 1999 with patients for 16 months, but there was further reduction noticed because number of patients was more, therefore obviously further reduction in the mortality. Then came the main CBIS-3 trial, and that was in 2005. And here it was like the ARNI or the trial with ARNI, they compared it with enalapril, the very good molecule ACE inhibitor. Was compared. So one group received 10 milligrams of bisoprolol and other one got 10 milligrams twice a day. Monotherapy was 6 months and other was combination therapy was 6 to 24 months. And they had the same endpoints like all-cause mortality, hospitalization, repeated congestive heart failure, etc., etc. So what was the result like? The CBIS-3 trial show this, see this. This is the tabulation of the trial. Initially, patients received 10 milligrams of bisoprolol, equal number of patients, and other group received 10 milligrams of bisoprolol plus ACE inhibitors like enalapril, 10 milligram BD. And this is what, again, primary endpoint, mortality and all-cause hospitalization, secondary endpoint, combined primary endpoint, monotherapy, commonly seen in all the patients. And that was the conclusion. The treatment of CHF before combination or initiated beta first predicted improve the survival, and therefore combined beta blockers, there were further reduction. This supports that a free choice between beta blocker and enalapril initial therapy, mild towards systolic hepatitis, suggests early beta introduces sudden death in the first reduces. Means this not only improves the cardiac failure, the stage of the cardiac failure that patient with stage 3 and 4 can come to stage 2, repeated hospitalization for cardiac failure is reduced significantly, and sudden cardiac deaths also are reduced when this combination is given. So now instead of enalapril, we have the ARNI, which can also be combined with any beta blockers among the three, the paradigm HF trial, which is popular for ARNI, which contains the ARNI and valsartan in combination with beta blockers. So this also can be extrapolated. The CBIS-3 results can be extrapolated to the paradigm HF trial and going to be very useful. Significantly reduced death during first year of treatment, 46% reduction of death when patients received both enalapril and bisoprolol, combination of enalapril to the patient who already received bisoprolol to start with. So that's how the results are now. CBC3 results are available. So this is my conclusion slide. Is preferred beta blocker for treatment of heart failure, angina, and hypertension. It is licensed for treatment of hypertension, cardiac failure, and angina. Bisoprolol has once a day daily dosage because of these properties we already seen, and we have a variety of strengths available so that you can up titrate the dosage as per the need of the patient. Because a lot of cardiac failure patients have already got 90 or 100 blood pressure. They don't have high blood pressure unless it's a diastolic heart failure. In that case, like they used to talk early because of the Pope study, that you start with a very small dose of ramipril and step up. Here also, you have a choice to start with 1.25 of bisoprolol, and it can be up titrated up to 10 milligrams. So therefore, we have many strengths available. During titration and during follow-up, you can have the change in the treatment. And it has got a favorable clinical outcome. It is not affected by liver disease or kidney disease. So that's an advantage. Can be given patients who are already on dialysis and hardly any side effect. It's a preferred beta blocker for patients in the reproductive life because there is no fear of erectile dysfunction, and preferred for patients who are undergoing surgery, where some people advocate stopping of beta blockers prior to surgery because of increased incidence of strokes following surgery. But this can be continued so that the blood pressure remains normal during the surgery. So these are all properties of this particular molecule. There are not many trials as compared to other ones, except for CBC1, 2, 3, but they are quite productive and their results are very encouraging, and that shows that it can be given as a monotherapy for isolated hypertension with or without angina. But if it comes to treatment of heart failure, then it should be combined with a powerful ACE inhibitor like enalapril. You have a choice between enalapril, perindopril or ramipril, which are also approved for cardiac failure. So with this, we go for the comments from the participants and observations from the participants.
Thank you, doctor.
Me vicharu karta question. Can I ask one question?
Yes, sir.
Satish, enalapril is very old molecule.
Yeah.
Then it is compared, bisoprolol is compared with enalapril. Yeah. What about the ARBs? Which is the better combination with this drug?
We don't have any study because this study also in our place 2005. Mm. And even in the paradigm HF, the ARB was compared to enalapril because they thought enalapril is a good molecule which can be given up to say 20, 40 milligrams also. But really, that was the choice of the team we undertook the study. We don't have any study both with ARNI or beta blockers as far as the ARBs are concerned.
Okay.
So ARBs should be considered in patients who don't tolerate ACEs.
Okay.
Choice will be always ACE, but there are some studies with telmisartan. If your patient is not tolerating either perindopril or ramipril or enalapril, then telmisartan becomes the next drug of choice, which can be combined with any beta blockers of your choice for treatment of congestive heart failure.
Whether CCB is safe?
CCBs may not. You may not need adding of CCBs unless patient remains hypertensive. And there also, we can give the CCBs of the non-dihydropyridine. We should not give like verapamil and the diltiazem. If you want to choose the CCB, you should see one of the newer CCBs which have kidney protective effect, like the azelnidipine and eponidipine, which indirectly will help. But there is no data about any CCBs being useful in the treatment of congestive heart failure, not as a monotherapy and not as a combination with bisoprolol, bisoprolol or any beta blocker for that matter, and even AC or ARBs.
Very good. What about the dose dependent, whether it is a dose dependent erectile dysfunction or the there is no dose dependency?
No. Even if you go up to 10 milligrams also, in order to control the patient's blood pressure and the heart rate, there is no fear of erectile dysfunction because it's a beta 1 selectivity.
Okay. And diabetes, it doesn't cause hyperglycemia or something like that?
No. It is lipid neutral. It is glucose neutral also. So, main problem came up with propranolol.
Okay.
Propranolol was blamed for glucose intolerance and raising the serum lipids. But subsequently, to some extent, atenolol also was contributing. But I doubt whether metoprolol, bisoprolol, and carvedilol and nebivolol have any action on lipids or diabetes.
Okay. You said that hypotension, we have to reduce the dose of diuretics rather than reducing the dose of bisoprolol. What is that?
Yeah, because a lot of patients, suppose the patient gets admitted with a decompensated heart failure in the hospital, we give aggressively intravenous furosemide, torsemide, we add eplerenone or aldactone, the other one. Or even some people require the metolazone also. Once they have a negative balance, their edema feet is gone, their edema on the sacrum also is gone. If you still continue diuretics, then there is a fear of low cardiac output state. So we have to modify it. And by the time you decide about discharging the patient, he should be discharged with a minimum dose of diuretics. And mainly control him on ACE inhibitors or ARBs and beta blockers or ARNI with beta blocker. So any patient who comes to you with complaints of weakness, low output state, low pressure, you must first reduce their diuretics. And even some people are already on nitrates. That also contributes to the hypotension. And the trials, paradigm shift trial shows that initially the patient may have a low pressure and you need not worry. You start with 50 milligrams of ARNI twice a day. And as the cardiac failure improves, the blood pressure starts coming up. By that time, you get a confidence to step up the dose of ARNI to 100 milligrams twice a day also. And these people do very well. So one need not worry about the low pressure. Find out the cause. And then you can adjust the dose. Because the benefits of pitaprolol and beta blockers and ACE inhibitors with or without ARNI should be offered to the patient. Any other drugs contributing to hypertension should be checked first.
Okay, some other person. Thank you very much.
Vasude.
Majhe zale question.
Any other comments? Anybody has any observation?
I want to make one comment. Previously, it was very commonly used, beta blockers, in hypertension and all those things. And people were having bronchial asthma. So the question was whether to continue or not. So they were not disturbed because of beta blocker. So some of the people, they get uncontrolled bronchial asthma. So in that case, we tell the cardiologist to do some other form of hypertensive agent.
No, basically the beta blockers were blamed and there was a lot of controversy or criticism because of the first beta blocker propranolol, which has got highest, I mean, which has got a main beta 2 selectivity, therefore they produce bronchial asthma. And therefore, all beta blockers were blamed. But now it is not so, because the newer beta blockers are quite safe. As far as the side effect of bronchospasm is concerned, after propranolol comes atenolol, then metoprolol, then bisoprolol, and lastly carvedilol, and above, on top of that is nebivolol. So now we have got a good molecule which can safely be given in patients of bronchial asthma with hypertension. As I mentioned, it's the drug which can be given in COPD and bronchial asthma. Initially, there was no other choice, so we continued with the propranolol, and we became wiser because of the side effects. Asthma was precipitated, so everybody said, no, this is because of propranolol. Let us not treat asthma patient hypertension with this. We have other molecules available.
So I'll get a lot of patients with cough. And to investigate, to rule out the possibility of bronchial asthma. So even by doing all these tests and everything, they don't have, but they are on telmisartan or almisartan. So yeah, sometimes whether that can give rise to a cough in a patient.
Yes, the highest side effect profile of cough is ACE inhibitors. That means either perindopril, ramipril, enalapril, all three are same. It's not that one is less than one other one. Initially, some patients respond to conventional treatment for cough suppressants. But if they still continue with that, then you change over to equivalent doses of ARBs. But ARBs also are not free with coughs as a side effect. ARBs also produce cough as a side effect. In that case, we have to go for either calcium channel blockers or alpha blockers or vasodilators. Nowadays, hydralazine is a good molecule. Prazosin is a good molecule. Moxonidine is a good molecule, like clonidine. So all these molecules are available if the patient is unable to tolerate ACE inhibitors or ARBs.
Do you recommend this drug as a first line of drug for the young adults?
Which one?
This beta blocker, bisoprolol. The first line of drug can you use in young patients when they have tachycardia?
Many patients.
They have anxiety.
Many patients I have given, especially I said, during their productive life, as soon as they get diagnosed as hypertension,
okay,
they develop anxiety and tachycardia. It works wonder. Both control of blood pressure, both control of tachycardia, and they get a confidence that it is not producing and affecting their sexual life.
Because nowadays for ABC, beta is nowhere the first line of treatment nowadays guidelines.
Indian
but
guidelines,
it depends on individual person.
Yeah, yeah.
The physician.
Indian guidelines and ACCHA 2018 guidelines show that any group drug is okay to start with, but they also recommend that you give a combination. That's why we have got combination of atenolol, metoprolol, bisoprolol with ACE inhibitors, amlodipine, mainly nifedipine, and they may come out with telmisartan also. So there's nothing like 1, 2, 3. It is your choice. What is the priority? You want to control the heart rate? Beta blocker is first. Like that. And then you want the compliance, then use a beta blocker which is longest acting. That's how you have to choose the molecule.
Right.
And obviously, we will never use ACE inhibitors and ARB combination.
Right.
Hello, Mirza is silent, right?
Yes, Mirza. Yeah. Where are you?
Mirza is silent.
No, but today's lecture was wonderful. You have covered all the points needed for us.
Yeah.
That is practical points.
Yeah, yeah.
And congratulations to Satish Vaidya.
I am of the opinion is beta blockers are unnecessarily blamed because of propranolol.
No.
I always say, to summarize, ki there is nothing like extrapolation of propranolol to other newer beta blockers. They are excellent drugs. And every drug has got its own identity. Like nebivolol, oh, safe for bronchiolitis. Carvedilol, safe, very good for cardiac failure. Advantage is that you can go up to 25 milligrams, right from 3.125 to 25. Okay. That much is the liberty of the titrating the thing. And therefore, there's... and the second thing is they are underused. I would say they are underused because of the fear and misdirection by JNC. JNC 8 was so late that it never came. So people were prejudiced. I would say Indian Hypertension Society took a brave, bold step to recommend beta blockers.
Kone re?
Natu.
Natu. Mota Natu na?
Are, I have to request my laptop from him for dinner. Otherwise, he is using the laptop, 1.5 lakhs laptop for school, first standard.
Oh.
ऐसा है.
छोटा काय म्हणतो? छोटा ना तू?
हा तो तर काय सुरू झाला, चालायला लागला.
चालायला लागला ना? हा. चालतोय का? बर, मजा आहे म्हणजे.
लास्ट डिव्हिजन इज 1C.
त्याचं नाव काय? त्याचं नाव काय?
नाव सांग, नाव सांग. बरं दिवस येतो ना तो.
माझ्या भावाचं नाव आहे स्वना.
अरे अद्वैत ट्यूशनला गेला आणि तर तुझ्याशी बोलला असता तो.
स्वनय सांग, SWANAY, स्वराज अँड स्वनय. येस, आणि स्वराज हॅव्हिंग हिज बर्थडे ऑन
25th. याचं नाव काय मोठ्याच?
स्वराज.
स्वराज
SWARAJ. स्वराज पॉल सारखा होणार आहे तो.
हो,
अँड हिज विल बी 7th. He will complete 7 years on 25th of this month.
Right.
So looking forward for his birthday.
Mm-hmm.
Chalo, Mr.
Chalo, okay, bye. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Sonu Singh, how was everything?
Thank you, sir. And thank you all respected audience for attending the wonderful session. And Dr. Swed, with your permission, we can end off the session.
Very good. Yes, yes. I have to leave for my clinic.
Mm.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, sir. Bye.
See you soon.
Yeah, see you.